Hello YouTube, I own you guys. It's something from really long time. I have to build finally this sound sculpture MC624 monitor controller. So everything is here as I left in the last time when I did the video about this. Let's start with the DIY guide. Okay, so they explain to you exactly what you need for a good DIY work. Of course, safety warning, whatever, what skills are needed. I think it's check. Good soldering iron, thermally regulated, 15 to 30 watt. Ta-da, this is what I have. It's from a Weller. It's a very professional level of tool. So it can go up to 80 watt, but of course, because this is fully thermal regulated. What is mean? The Weller installed here a very smart sensoring system, which is controlling your tip temperature, but on a really interested way. Later on, I will do for you guys infrared camera footage about this, how this small, really tiny soldering iron can provide to you a lot of thermal energy, even if the tip is really small. The Weller have other kind of soldering irons. They have a much more smaller version for really fine work for soldering, and they also have much more bigger, which is, of course, is much more bigger. So this is the size comparison, yeah? So this is 60 watt. And this is 80 watt, unbelievable technology. It's kind of magic, I'm telling you guys. So I have from the Weller this also, and this is the soldering iron what I'm using on the field. So for example, in car or in construction fields or in heavy duty electric installations. And if you believe or not, but this tip is almost 15 year old, unbelievable. It's always working, it has a fixed temperature, but it's working really well, so it's not burning the parts, it's not burning the cable, it's doing the work exactly. Time to time even I'm using this on really fine electronic, because this really big heavy tip here, it can hold a lot of thermal energy. So what is mean when I have to do a big soldering, for example, heavy power cables, which is going to the PCB. This is the tool what I'm using. Or for this very small soldering iron, I have here another set of tip from a Weller. And this one is much more bigger than the fine tip. Maybe you can see like this. So this one, it's providing even more thermal energy than my big soldering iron. Of course, everything, every part is ESD protected. It's not a joke. So I think this is check. The next one, they writing to you what kind of solder you need. So they prefer the 0.8 millimeter to 1 millimeter. I have a really nice quality Stanol solder, which is only half millimeter diameter. But of course, in the middle, this solder, it's contain a flux core in a star shape, so it's a really sophisticated, really high quality solder. I really like it, and it's contained 2.5% of silver. Even I have another kind from Weller, and this what I got with my old big heavy industrial soldering iron. This they give me as a present in a shop, and this is after 15 years of usage, and believe me, guys, I'm using this the soldering like how you eat the bread every day. And this is what is remained from that. Unfortunately, I lost the stamp from the bottom, so I cannot tell you exactly what kind of solder is this, but it's really melting really well, really quick, really fastly, and is not releasing almost nothing smoke. And I think it's also contain around 2% of silver. It's exactly 1 millimeter, so this line is checked. Cutters, oh yeah, I have many different kind and type of cutters. Phillips screwdriver, oh my god, I have millions. So this one check. A good digital multimeter with insulated test hooks, yeah, industry standard from EV blog, is the Fluke 87V. Of course, I have the Schlumberger desk multimeters, which is 6.5 digits. We will use mostly this Fluke 87V, and for the really fine, really precise measurements, we will use the Schlumberger 7150 plus 6.5 digit benchtop multimeter. From that I have two pieces, so we can measure current and voltage together, or voltage and resistance, whatever combination. So if you don't have really high precision benchtop multimeters, don't worry, you can finish this project with that, because the components you will see later on, it's not absolutely extreme precision components. So, and component wires bender, yeah, my favorite tool in this box. They give you this really nice bender. So this will definitely, we will use it for the resistors, for the capacitors, for diodes, whatever. I only missing from that only one thing, what I had in the past, which is somebody stolen from me, or I lost somewhere, I don't know. It has here on the end a vertical bender solution also. So it had here a very small hole, what you can plug one leg, and then you just bend to the other side. And from this hose on the end, it had three different size and three different distance from the edge. So this is what I'm missing only from this bender, but I think we can survive with my pliers. This soldering pump and this soldering braid. What is braid? So from that, I have a really high quality Valer. By the way, the Valer have from that a new version, but somehow, maybe because this is what I get used to, so somehow I find that this one is much more better for my applications. So this is the DSX80 desoldering tool from the Valer, and this is connected to my VMD3 Valer station. And I just like it, I really love it. It's never failed on me. It's really easy to clean, it's really easy to replace the tip. By the way, this is the third tip after 10 years or something like this. So this is again a really professional grade tool from the Valer, and the thermal control is just amazing. It's never burned nothing, and it's just doing the job on the right way. But again, if you guys have something simpler, so this one I bought on eBay a couple of years ago as just like my safety disorder on a construction field. It's okay, I think it's much more better than this, really exactly this one. So this type I really hate it. It's one of the most shittiest tool in desoldering or in soldering works. This one is much more better quality, and it has a really nice sucking power, and the precision is much more better than this kind, what you can see here. Let's say if you are not serious on electronic like me, for example, this kind, it's, I think it's enough for you. So from a wire striper, I have two kind, and this is what I really like. This tool, of course, this from the Nipex from Germany. Absolutely precise tool. I really like the weight of it, the edge here inside, which is striping the cable, is just fantastically sharp. It's just razor sharp, really. And I really like this old kind of brush adjustment here, yeah. So it's just gorgeous. I'm telling you guys, if you wanna buy a really good wire striper, this is the choice only. I tried many different kind and many different kind of solution, and this is the best because it just works, yeah? And this is precise. Tweezers, oh my God. So from tweezers, I have many different type and kind, but this is my favorite because it have a really good angle and it has a really pin sharp tip. So with that I can do almost any kind of work. So if you wanna go under the part, you can go under, or if you wanna grab from the top and you have a limited access to the space, with this you can go in. Of course, from that I have a straight one, and from the straight one I have other kind, which is much more smaller, much more finer tweezer. Maybe you can see like this. And I have from this type with this different tip on the end. This is the best for desoldering SMD capacitors because this size here on the end of the tip is absolutely is matching with the size of SMD capacitors. And yeah, I really like it. So the brand is Vetus. I think it's Vetus. This is how we have to pronounce it. Maybe you can see already, but each of my tweezer is ASD, which is, let's say, it's not necessarily if you're just dealing with really analog stuffs, but if you're dealing with really sensitive digital parts or desoldering or soldering, this is what you need. Yeah, from this set even, I'm just using really just most of the time this one. So I think we can put a check here. Hot air gun. From that I have again a Weller. Let's say rather I like it for SMD works, but for big works, this hot air gun is not give you enough power on the end. So yeah, maybe you can see it already. So the size is limiting the applications of this hot air gun. But of course I have this kind, not from Boss, from Makita, if I remember good, which is, let's say, is good for heavy desolderings or whatever, for really construction applications. I'm not recommended to use this kind in electronic works because, believe me guys, even if you turn it to the lowest settings, let's say 200 Celsius or something, you easily can get here about 400, 500 Celsius if something is blocking the airflow. This one, on the other end, it's perfect. So the temperature sensor, it's here somewhere in the end, so it's never can happen. You did a setup on your desoldering station, let's say 228 degree, and here you get like 400, 500 or 600, which is what you can easily can get with this kind of hot air gun. So this is absolutely on a temperature control, absolutely professional. Of course, everything again, anti-static, ESD, whatever. The cable is really soft and guys, this you have to feel it. So this is again not a joke. I think we covered because this size of hot air is also good for the applications of what they writing here. So example, a hot air gun for shrinking heat shrink tubings. So this is good for that. I think we covered it. So let's say check. Okay, let's check my deluxe tools, yeah? Oscilloscope, okay, I have 1, 2, 3, 4 oscilloscope and one in a box. I just ordered now. But for a signal generator, I have here this really nice EMU sound card, actually. But what I really like about this one, as a signal generator, it have the outputs you can configure on a hardware side, so it will be balanced or unbalanced. And when you configure to unbalanced, you can hear a click of the relay instance. So this is not a half driven, or so this is not a half driven output with some kind of resist or trigger or whatever. This is a real balanced and real unbalanced solution on the end. So when I switch to unbalanced, you will hear it on under the test. So if we switch, it's do some kind of switching by relay, which is meaning the unbalanced and balanced output is using total different solution on electronics or a different configuration of the same output driver. And of course, it's let's say it's top notch on a quality, so it's 128 decibel dynamic range, 192k sampling rate, 24 bit, blah 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 blah, and it has also built-in generators. I will show you guys later when we do a test. So it can generate for you pink noise, white noise, brown noise, black noise, green noise, whatever, and also simple oscillator. And it has a built-in DSP system, so with that you can do a hardware-based EQing, dynamic compression, gate, whatever, and any, I don't know how many different kind of effects is built inside in a DSP, so it's not using the computer to generate these things. Also, the signal generator inside is based on hardware. So this is what we will use as a signal generator. I think it will be enough for this DIY building. So I think we can put check and check on both of the things. Component list, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pages. So they give you a full documentation about assembling, setup, soldering, parts, PCB, whatever. So this is not a joke, guys. So this one is showing you the component layout for the power, the switching power supply unit. And again, you can see here how you must to do specific parts. So this one is not a horizontal, this is a vertical soldering what you have to apply here. They marked where the cathode has to be, here you can see. So here is your diode, and they marked which leg it has to be the cathode, which is same like here. So they did this one also on the main board component layout. So every part has its own dedicated number, values, whatever. Really nice documentation. Thank you very much, guys. So even the voltages of the capacitors, everything. So you cannot do a mistake if you follow this component layout. This is the semantics for the inputs, and the first buffer amplifier, and whatever. What is this more? So let's say this is the signal chain. So input, buffer, here somewhere we will have the unbalanced balanced switcher, and also the attenuator electronic here, and this is your output. Then you have this one, of course, left and right side, and CZ1 and CZ20 is optional. Why? This monitor controller is fully balanced inside, outside. So what is mean? If you have here capacitive coupling, it's meaning you will lose something. Because there is no two capacitor on a planet which is exactly on the same capacity or exactly on the same values on any kind of physical measurements, let's say like this. So what is mean? If you apply here a capacitor, you lose almost the half of the goodies of this really nice and beautiful, fully balanced design. Because it's these capacitors can give you a differences between the two line, which is the positive and the negative from the balance. So why it's optional? Let's say you have here an old gear, let's say the last gear on your mastering chain is generating some kind of DC offset. So if you switch between inputs, it can be and it's possible you will hear some kind of pop or click, because this DC offset is different from, let's say, from this DC offset. And then, of course, the first the driver op-amp, it has to follow this DC offset. So it's meaning you can hear pops or clicks. So this is not the faulty design of the MC624. It's exactly showing you how this design is perfect. So if you have here a big DC offset or something else, you must need to install capacitive coupling here. If you don't have any kind of DC offset, I hope I don't have, yeah? So if you don't have any kind of DC offset issues here on the outputs of your gears, of course you can just forgot this capacitor. And it's true also on the output. So again, if you have here DC offset problem, of course, because the design, it's so beautiful and so elegant, of course you will get the DC offset problem here on the end. So this is why they designed, again, optional capacitive coupling on the output. Okay, this semantics is about the headphone amplifier. The input is balanced, of course. The output is unbalanced, of course. Or I know have clue. We will see later on how this one is built up. By the way, what I can see here already, the output impedance, it can go down to 12 ohm. So this one definitely can drive consumer grade headphones. If, for example, if you really like some kind of Sony or Panasonic consumer grade headphone, don't worry. This can drive for you, because the IC what they're using here is the LT1206, which is a really high precision, really high power driver. And of course, to drive this one, you have to apply some kind of op-amp, yeah? So what they choose here is the OP2134, which is, I think this is the one of the highest high-end op-amp in audio engineering industry. Of course, it's done by Birnbaum. So this design is really elegant and really simple. And maybe you can see here, so the negative feedback is not coming from between the last buffer amplifier and between the headphone driver amplifier. So the negative feedback, it's coming back from the headphone to the buffer amplifier here, which is absolutely a gorgeous design. So what is mean? If you have here any kind of distortion which is caused by your headphone, because the negative feedback is going back from the end, it's meaning this circuit here will compensate the errors of your headphone. Brilliant design, brilliant. So what is mean in this configuration, these two amplifiers is working together like one, let's say, operational amplifier. So it will be lower the current noise, it will lower the voltage noise, it will lower the offset error, everything. And also we compensate the errors of your headphone. Next one, this is boring, so this is digital. Peak 18, nothing fancy. Yeah, this is the power input, so this DC to DC converter, which is converted the 12 volts into minus 16 and to plus 16. So definitely this is the power source for the op amps and for the amplifiers, and this one has to be really precisely adjusted because of the fully balanced design. They designed a total different output for a metering, which is meaning if you plug your metering solution to the output of your monitor controller, it will not bother the signal. So the meter bridge is driven again with a really high quality operational amplifiers from Burbron, which is the 2134. We will use this port, of course, because I have some kind of El Cheapo measurement on my monitoring. So again, really nice design and really nice touch. Time to do the assembly, yeah? I saw it somewhere. Okay, let me do here some kind of organization, yeah? I hope you guys enjoyed. See you tomorrow.